All right, today we're talking about the differences we made on this intake manifold. We increased the plenum volume about 50%. I did post a video about of the fab work in that. I will post the link to that in the description of this video. This one here, we're gonna go back to the dyno quick. And I'm gonna show you the pull we made from the dyno, my initial reactions to the dyno graph differences. And then I'm gonna go through a bunch of data with you here. I got some prior runs I wanna compare to. The data log from the dyno session that I want to show you and try to explain why the intake manifold didn't make as big of a difference as I thought it would. Maybe not necessarily explain it to you isn't really the right term, but more me trying to understand it, and you guys can kind of follow along in my thought process there. But yeah, check it out. All right, a couple things quick. Already did the dyno test, obviously, as you saw. Wanted to just talk about a couple things. I haven't finished this pipe up yet. I want to put a pressure sensor in here to measure pre-intercooler pressure to see if the intercooler is becoming a restriction. But so I knew right away that the intake manifold didn't make a significant difference. And it turns out it was pretty hard for me to like 100% nail down the before and afters. But what I can tell you is the fuel trims were pretty much the same. And if you look here, this was the last pull on the stock ECU with the turbo 400, and then the pull from today. Now the top line in the middle here, the higher one, is from the old setup with the stock ECU, the other intake manifold deal. And you can see up here the lines pretty much match, which tells me that it doesn't fall away as much up top, so it's worth something. But I mean, the numbers even up here, the numbers are only like 8 horsepower difference. So definitely didn't make a significant change like what I was hoping. Again, the fuel trims look similar. If you look at this a little differently and I open up the last test I made, so this was in March. So the air was significantly different, right? Obviously because it is currently September 2nd. So if I open up the last test I made with the Haltech ECU, the same boost level, here it looks significantly better. I mean, significantly better out there, way better. So depending on where you look, it made a big difference or it didn't make a big difference. We'll just have to take it to the track and find out. But yeah, out here, I'm hoping that that's more realistic. I wish I had some data logs from that dyno session back then, but I don't believe that I do. I'm gonna confirm that. I might, so I will look that up. But I know the boost levels are within 0.5 pound of the same and that kind of thing. So yeah, anyway. Hopefully it wasn't a complete waste of time. It looks like we gained a little something up there, and that's how it goes. You know, sometimes you work at stuff and it helps and sometimes it doesn't. But let me get this thing back in the trailer and head home, and I'll get that pre-intercooler pressure sensor set up before we go to the track, hopefully. And yeah, I think this thing's ready to go. We're just gonna go to the track, see how much difference it makes, turn it up, see if we can go fast. So yeah, that's the plan.
Okay, a couple things to note here. So here's the first graph from the March thing. Now, obviously, you can't see the power graph right now, but I wanted to show you this down here. So this is the DA from the 2 days. This is the DA in March. So negative 369 feet. So the density altitude, the corrected altitude, was 369 feet below sea level. The test we just did with the new plenum is almost 2,300 feet above sea level. Significant power difference there. The dyno does have a weather station and does create a correction factor based on the DA at the time, but I just don't know how accurate it is. And here you can see the total numbers, the peak numbers here. This was the pull with the new manifold. This was it with the old manifold in the better DA. And here's the graph difference. Zoom out a little bit. You see here how it separated a little further, and then as the RPM came up, the old setup fell off more. This one kind of stayed the same. Again, I don't know how significant the changes were because of the DA, the DA spread is so much, right? So I'm gonna look at this graph, which is more recent. So there's a couple things here to keep in mind as well. The DA down here, I'll click on this again. But here's the DA down here. So this was the test we just did was 14.6 PSI, so it's almost 9 tenths of a pound more, right? The DA was also worse than it's 3,100 pounds, or 3,100 pounds, listen to me, 3,100 feet of DA in the 2,300 or 2,288, whatever we had when we did the test. Here are the peak numbers here. But again, it's 8 tenths of a pound different. This also had the full exhaust on it, a handful of differences. Wrong direction. One more here. So this was a little later in the day. This was the first, or a little later in the year than the March test. This was the first test I did with the, this was open exhaust, the old intake manifold setup on the haul tech. And you can see the intake manifold made a significant difference there. But again, the DA is so much different. It was negative almost 1,000 feet according to air density online. It was almost negative 1,000 feet of DA this day, and when we did the current test, the 704 number here was 2,300 feet. So again, a significant difference. Here's the totals in the density altitude, and the dyno does correct for that, as I said, but I don't know how accurate that is. So I'm thinking the test results. I just don't have a good A to B test. I feel like really the only way to do that, to have a true good A to B test, would be to have done the intake manifold change the same day on the dyno to know for sure. At any rate, using the DA and these dynographs is one way to do it. Here's another way to look at this, and I'll tell you what I think about these other assumptions I'm making or other thought processes I have here. All right, so our goal was to try to make more horsepower in a later RPM range. Due to how I have this car geared is one issue. It's got a 410 in the back because it's got such a long first gear in the transmission. It is a 165 first gear turbo 400, meaning that I can't pull gear out of the back of it to lower the RPM range through the traps on the big end. So instead, I wanted to try to make more horsepower up in that 8,000 RPM area. Now, when this thing was NA, it made peak power at like 8,100. And ever since I put the turbo setup on, it just hasn't been making big power up top. It makes peak power around 71. I'm still shifting it at 75. It goes through the traps like 155 mile an hour on their old stock engine record. The current stock engine record, I guess, was 7,800. And we're gonna try to go faster. I'm planning the thing to spin 81, but it just makes no horsepower up there. So here's a couple other thoughts with the intake manifold change. Again, trying to add plenum volume, thinking that that was the reason it wasn't making power up at 8,100. So this track here, this is kind of interesting. This is exhaust back pressure delta, EMAP delta, exhaust manifold pressure delta, whatever you want to call it. So you see here, it's 2 pounds, right? So up here is our, I'll just put RPM over this so you guys can better understand what I'm getting at. RPM, and then I will put manifold pressure in there as well. Okay, so what's happening, what's seen here that's interesting is it's 2 pounds or so and up to 9 pounds. So what we're seeing here as the pressure falls is when the gate starts to crack and it starts regulating pressure. And here at 6,000 RPM, it's negative 1 PSI, meaning we have 1 pound less back pressure than we do boost pressure. So we've got 15 pounds of back pressure. We've got up here, you can see I have the actual pressure reading in raw, not the math channel. You see we have 14 pounds of back pressure. As RPM comes up here at say 7,500, we're up 1 pound, right? And you see that here, we're up almost, just about a little over 1 pound there. So what that is telling me is that we're just creating exhaust back pressure. I'm wondering if that's why the power curve doesn't look very good up top, why it doesn't make power up top, if the drive pressure increase, it not being linear through the run, if this stayed at an effective of negative one or zero, 1 to 1 back pressure, drive pressure to manifold ratio the whole pass, if the power curve would look better up top. Now that makes sense if I look at this as an aspect of manifold pressure is constant. It's 14 pounds the whole hit, right? And if manifold pressure is constant, and EMAP is going up with RPM, that would tell me that the effective boost is essentially falling the difference here, right? So if it's here, it's negative one in the beginning. Well, at that one hit, it's negative one. It's basically 1-to-1. So call that, instead of 15 pounds of manifold pressure, you could look at that as, say, 16 down there, which is, this is around peak power here, right? When it's a little over, it's one to one base, or it's 1 pound over here. And up top here, when it gets high, when it gets to 2 pounds over, it's still 15 pounds of boost, but 2 pounds of back pressure instead of, like, you know, the one. So that's a pound of boost difference, I would say, up top. So it's going to have essentially a 2 pound of pressure swing through the RPM range. Now, manifold pressure is constant. So again, this is a delta pressure across that has a 2 pound swing through the RPM range. And I'm wondering if that is the reason that we're seeing the power curve fall off so bad up top. It's just a drive pressure issue. But it definitely wasn't the intake manifold. And here's my biggest reason as to why I don't think the intake manifold made a difference. I feel like this is the reason in the power curve, the manifold pressure delta is there. But to prove that the intake manifold didn't make a big change, you just watch the fuel trims. So they're negative 3%, negative 4%. That is through the entire RPM range, and that is the exact same number I have seen on the other setups as well. So the if I was looking to increase the VE curve, my car would make more power with RPM. This should have been a lesser number up here. We should have seen a VE change, and we just don't. So the intake manifold hasn't affected the volumetric efficiency of the engine, just meaning that there is another cork somewhere in the system that we just haven't found yet. As I mentioned in the video from the dyno run there, I'm planning to do a pre-cooler pressure sensor in it, wondering if maybe that's some of the reason the drive pressure is going up top to maintain the same manifold pressure. It could be that that cooler is becoming a problem. It is a Garrett 1,000 horse core. Now at this power level that was only in that 700 wheel area, it is around 1,000 flywheel with that converter in it though. So it's possible that that core is a problem. I've seen other people claim that they've made 2,000-ish horsepower through that same core. So I don't know if that's realistic. But that pressure sensor pre-intercooler will tell us that. And we'll go from there. But, yeah, so this is the data from that dyno session. And that's kind of all my thought processes on why I don't think the intake manifold made a big difference and what possibly our true problem is with the EMAP to manifold pressure delta pressure here, and possibly the intercooler being a restriction. All of that said, I don't think that the intake manifold plenum volume change was a move in the wrong direction. I feel like whenever we uncork this thing, figure out what the actual limitation is in the air, in the, you know, it's essentially a big air pump. But once we figure out what the actual restriction is in that system, the plenum volume is still going to be advantageous to us. It feels kind of like like I wasted a bunch of time currently, but hopefully that thought process stays true as we uncork the thing, figure out what the restriction actually is, and make bigger power with it down the road. We're just going to continue to learn here with this thing. So, yeah, moving forward, we're going to go to the track and see how big of a difference it made there. Maybe that will shed some light on it and show something different than the dyno did, just due to the fact that the DA was so all over the place and all those passes I had for comparisons. But yeah, that's it for this video. Sorry, I know it's super tech heavy. And I kind of struggled to explain the manifold pressure delta stuff. I took like 3 takes of this video to get it to this point. So you can only imagine how rough the first couple were. But keep following along as we learn through this thing. I'm going to, like I said, do the pre-intercooler pressure test. We're going to go to the track here in a couple weeks, do some testing there. And yeah, hopefully the results will come back. We may have to put a different intercooler on the car. You know, you never know. We're just, this thing is evolving, and you guys can follow along and evolve with us as I'm learning this stuff. So, yeah, keep following along and look for our next video.